All right, welcome to the second section of chapter 7. In the last section, we talked about polygons in general and some of the different properties of their angles. It has a bunch of angle formulas. Now, this section is where we're going to really start to focus on just the quadrilaterals. So the primary focus of this chapter is quadrilaterals. What are the special types? What are their special properties? So the first thing, we're going to define a quadrilateral, which is something we talked a little bit about in the last section. So a quadrilateral is any four-sided polygon. So anything that has four sides is considered a quadrilateral. So you have some examples down here below, all of which have four sides. And it really doesn't matter what the shape looks like. So it can be something like this. It can be something like this. If it has four sides, it's considered a quadrilateral, okay? So that's one thing to think about, is basically what we're talking about this entire chapter is quadrilaterals. So within quadrilaterals, what are the different special types and what are their special properties? So we're going to talk about one specific type today, and that's parallelograms. And so these you might have been introduced to sometime in your previous math classes. If not, we're going to be going through what they are and then what's special about them. So a parallelogram, which is what we're looking at here, is a quadrilateral with both pairs of opposite sides parallel. And this is really important because this is one of the first big properties of a parallelogram. So we have opposite sides that are parallel, and that's what these little arrows in the picture down below here mean. So AB is parallel to DC, AD is parallel to BC. Now when we name quadrilaterals in general, so this isn't specific to parallelograms, but anytime we name a quadrilateral, we just pick a point on the outside and we just follow it around the outside of the shape. So I could start at point D and call this parallelogram DABC. Or I could have started at A and called it ABCD or ADCB. So as long as you pick a point and just go around the outside of the figure, you can name it whatever you want as long as you use the four letters. Now, as far as opposite sides, it's going to be important for us to be able to identify opposite parts of the figure, and you're going to see why here in a little bit when we go through the properties. So for opposite sides, that would be like side AB and side CD. Those would be opposite one another, so they're the ones across from each other. And then you'd also have side AD across from side BC as well. As far as angles are concerned, that's another thing that's going to be important in these figures, opposite angles. So those are the ones that are directly across from each other. Like here we have angle A and angle C would be opposite angles. Or we have angle D and angle B would be opposite angles. So being able to identify those opposites is going to be really important. And then the last one is called consecutive angles. So consecutive is like one after the other or one following the next. So for consecutive angles, that would be like angle C right here. And then if I just work my way around the picture, angle D would be consecutive. So angle C and angle D would be consecutive angles. Or angle D and angle A are next to each other. Or angle A and angle B. So it's just like you're working your way around the figure, which angles are next to each other. That's consecutive. Now, with parallelograms, the first major property, like we said, was right here. Opposite sides are parallel, and we're going to be keeping track of these as we go because we're going to have to use these properties to solve for missing pieces within the picture. So now the rest of the properties are right here listed in these theorems, and I have everything marked in the picture already, so we're going to kind of highlight as we go here. So for this first theorem, okay, what they're saying is within a parallelogram, opposite sides are congruent. So on the definition, opposite sides were parallel, but now we also get that opposite sides are congruent. So if I'm looking at my parallelogram here, and here's where those opposite sides come into play, this side CD is congruent to this side AB. And then this side AD on top is congruent to this side BC on the bottom. So opposite sides are always going to be congruent to one another. And so like if they said CD has a length of 10, what is AB? Well, it's got to be the same because they're opposite from each other. Or if they said AD has a length of 2x plus 4 and BC has a length of 3x minus 10, what is x or what's the length? Well, I know those are equal. So 3x minus 10 equals 2x plus 4, and then I can solve for x. So there's lots of things we can do with that as we're looking at those opposite sides. So the opposite sides are always congruent to each other. If we look at the next theorem, it says opposite angles of a parallelogram are congruent. So angle C down here in this corner would be congruent to angle A up here in this corner, opposite angles. And so then the other set of opposite angles, angle D, would be congruent to angle B. And again, we use this because if they say angle C is 55 degrees, what's the measure of angle A? Well, it's going to be 55 degrees. Or if they say angle D is 3x plus 5 and angle B is 1x plus 30, we can set those equal to each other and solve for x. So opposite angles are always going to be congruent to one another. Okay. Now the third theorem here, consecutive angles of a parallelogram add up to 180. So consecutive, remember, were the ones next to each other. So like angle C here and angle D would add up to 180 degrees. So if I told you angle C was 50, angle D would have to be 130. And then if I worked my way around the figure, it's all the way around, just add up to 180. So then when I go from here to here, we go 180. From here to here would be 180, so this would have to be 50 again. And then from here to here would be 180, so this would be 130. And then it just reinforces our opposite angles are congruent. Both sets of opposites were identical. So when you're looking at the angles, if they're across from each other, they're the same. If they're next to each other, they're going to add to 180. So that's going to be an important concept there. And then the last one, so this fourth theorem, the diagonals bisect each other. And remember, bisect just means cut in half. So when I draw the diagonals in, so if I connect my opposite angles, A to C and B to D, when I put both of those diagonals in, they're going to cut each other in half. These two pieces are going to be identical. These two pieces are going to be identical. So technically what we have here is five properties for parallelograms, and we have to use those properties to help solve for missing pieces within the figure. So they might do something like this, where they give you a parallelogram. So complete each statement about the parallelogram, GRAM. And so we're just filling in the blanks based on the information in the picture. So it says it's a parallelogram. So in the first statement right here, it says MG must be parallel to what? So here's MG, and we said that in a parallelogram, opposite sides are parallel. So if I go from MG straight across my parallelogram, AR would be the side that I'm parallel to, so side AR. Or if we look at the next statement, it says MS is congruent to what? So MS is this segment right here. They're asking, that's congruent to what? Well, that's part of a diagonal. And in a parallelogram, the diagonals bisect each other. So that means the other part of my diagonal must be identical as well. So MS would be congruent to line RS because those diagonals are cut in half. If we look at the next shape or the next statement here, it says angle MGR is congruent to what? So M to G to R. We're talking this angle right here. Well, if we're talking congruent, opposite angles are congruent. So if I come across the parallelogram, the other angle across from it is going to be angle MAR. And so those opposite angles are going to be congruent to one another. So we're just kind of filling in blanks what we know from here. Now this one's a little bit trickier. The next one says GS is equal to 1/2 of what? So GS is this piece right here. It's part of the diagonal. So we remember the diagonals cut each other in half. So GS should be 1/2 of the entire diagonal from G to A. And then the last picture, or the last property here, it says triangle MAR. Now triangle MAR is this triangle right here. So it wants to know what other triangle is it congruent to. Well, we know that AR is congruent to MG because opposite sides are congruent. We know AM is congruent to RG because opposite sides are congruent. And then we have a shared side in the middle here. And so when we go here, we have to be really careful that we match things up appropriately. So I went M, A, R. So I went through the 2 and then the 1 mark. So if I want to do that same thing over on the other triangle, I need to go through the 2 from R to G, and then through the 1 to M. So I got to make sure I match up the figures correctly. Okay, so this is one type of problem where you're just using those properties to fill in blanks or match things up within the picture. Another thing you might be doing is solving for missing pieces. So in this case, we have V, W, X, Y, and Z, all values we need to find within the picture. So if we think about what's going on here, a couple of things. We know opposite sides are congruent. So right here, I know V has to equal 16 because it's opposite from the 16. Likewise, I can find W fairly easily because it's across from the 13 and opposite sides are congruent, so W must also be 13. Now, as far as the angles are concerned, one angle that would be fairly straightforward to find would be Z, because opposite angles are always congruent. So Z would have to be the same as the 118. Now, from here, we can then go to Y. Now here we have to think about this a little bit differently. So when I go to Y, that's next to the 118. So it's not opposite from, it's next to it. And so consecutive angles have to add up to 180, so Y would equal 62 degrees. And then if Y is 62, I can follow that across to X, that's a linear pair, X would have to equal 118. And so when you're looking for the missing pieces like this, that's all you're doing is just applying those properties. So think about opposite sides or opposite angles, consecutive angles, what's the relationship, and then just apply it to the picture. Last couple of things, working with parallelograms in the coordinate plane. So we have a parallelogram where L is at 1-4. So L is going to be right there. M is at 7-4. So right there, so we've got L, M, N is at 6-0, and O is right at 0-0. So we're looking right at that. So here's my parallelogram. Now, what it wants to know is, where is the intersection of the diagonals? So if I draw the diagonals into my picture here, we want to know where this point right in the middle, so I'm going to highlight that in a different color here so we can see it. I want to know right where this point right here is. And so my drawing's not perfect, so I can't just use the drawing and say, oh, it's right here. So what we have to think about is the diagonals cut each other in half, meaning this point that I've highlighted in red should be halfway along either of the two diagonals. So if I highlight the diagonals, I have L goes to N. If I can find the midpoint between L and N, that's what I want to be able to find here. Or I could find the midpoint of M and O. So if I'm going to find the midpoint, that formula, so to calculate midpoint, I take the X's, so 1 and 6, and I add them together. So 1 plus 6, and then I'm going to divide that by 2. And then I take the Y's, 4 and 0, and I add those together and divide by 2. And so if I take 1 plus 6 is 7, divided by 2 gives me 3.5. 4 plus 0 is 4, divided by 2 is 2. So where the two diagonals meet is right at that midpoint of 3.5 and 2. So if I went to the right 3.5 and up 2, I would go right to that spot. So when you're looking at where the diagonals meet, it's just a midpoint. Pick one diagonal, calculate the midpoint, and you've got your intersection. Now, this last example, we have 3 of the 4 vertices for our parallelogram. So they tell us that X is at -3, +2 right here. It tells us W is at -1, -3. So we're right there. And then it says that Z is at 4, -4. Now, so there's our 3 points. So if I connect those, I've got kind of the start or the first half of my parallelogram. Now, to find where Y would be located. So as I go around here, it's going to go W to X, X to Y, Y to Z, but I need to figure out where Y is going to be. So if I use that idea that the sides are parallel, opposite sides have to be exactly the same, If I look at W to X, if I go from W to X, I have to go up 5 units. That's what this is saying. I'm gonna use a different color here. So the 5 units up, and then we go 2 units to the left. So from W to X, I went up 5 and left 2. Well, that means to find Y, if I start at Z, I'm gonna go up 5 and left 2, and we find where Y has to end up, which in this case, point Y would be at positive 2, positive 1. So when you're looking for like a missing coordinate in your parallelogram, simply figure out how do I move from one point to the next on this side and then move the exact same way on the other. And you should be able to find the coordinate that way. So with that information, you should be able to complete the assignment, which is the worksheet that you should get in class, or you can get it off of Google Classroom. As you're working, make sure you ask questions or make sure you utilize the answer key as it becomes available, and try to have that finished up and ready to go so you can turn that in at the deadline.